Guten Tag, everyone.
Yeah, welcome to Eine Podcasten.
Welcome, my friends. This is the podcast that's full of mysterious chocolate. Yeah? Yeah?
I couldn't...
Nine?
There is no place on a map I can put a thumbtack for whatever the weird accent. It was like French German? I guess there is a border there. And depending on the year.
That would be Belgium, I guess,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I guess. But there was like some Swedish chef going on there. And there was it mysterious chocolate?
What other kind is there on this podcast?
That's true. We don't want no regular chocolate. Just the mysterious ones that only come in the mix what is it, Mr. Goodbar?
Mr. Goodbar, 100 grand, cacao bean.
Yeah, those things don't... Like, Mr. Goodbar, you don't see. That's not for sale anywhere but in the bag of tiny candy bars.
That is true! Yeah. Crackle, too.
Yeah.
Crackle's good. Crackle's my favorite out of that bag.
Yeah. Crackle. I like the Special Dark.
Really?
Yeah.
You and I would get along then, because I never eat the Special Dark.
We'll never have a cocoa war.
This is Blurry Photos! Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
Welcome, dear listener.
I'm the non-German David Flora.
I'm the good old Dave Stecko of the USA, working hard for Joe Blisterfoot out on the front lines.
Hope everybody's doing well. We've got a good show for you tonight.
Oh, don't we?
Don't we?
We do.
Do we?
I raised a question, then I answered it. Don't we? We do. Mr. Flora, how you been this week, my friend?
I've been okay. Staying out of the ice sheet that has covered the Midwest.
Oh, man, not me. I'm relishing in it. I got some sweet new boots from my friend Egon and his lovely wife, Rebecca.
Man, the thing is, I have boots, and I've been out in it, but the boots then tweaked my Achilles tendon or something, if you want to get specific about
boot
it.
Bite.
Boot bite. Boot bit back. But... My ankle has been has seen better days. I blame the weather.
Yeah, I would. I feel good with blaming the weather for things.
Ugh. But other than that, been good. How about you?
Man, it's been great. It's been a nice busy week. I, as you know, relish the cold weather. The worse it gets, the happier I am.
Mm.
And with the addition of these completely winter-proof, awesome-ass boots, I couldn't be happier.
That's awesome.
I'm a real son of a bitch like that. I'm that guy who's just smiling, getting pelted in the face with slush.
Yeah, well, I would like to say that my Wampa hat served me well.
Oh, that Wampa hat is so cool!
Thing is, it's got flaps, and the wind blows up in those flaps. So I've kind of had to double up on my hat wear. Listen, hey, let me...
You ever get some cold air in your Wampa flaps?
let me ask you a question. What do you call the hats that you wear in the winter where you're from?
Oh, just hat.
Oh,
literally, see, just hat. I know
a lot of people don't even think about it.
If you were Canadian, they're all toques. And I know that's a specific kind of hat.
Huh.
But I think that it's just all winter hats that have like ear flaps file under toques.
What if they don't have a winter ear flap? What if they're just? I've heard them called beanies, knit caps. Where I was raised, I call them toboggans.
And that's ridiculous.
Okay, see, then that's usually the response that I get.
Yeah, no, the toboggan is a sled, not a hat. Thermal hat. I just like thermals. Thermal hat. I don't know. Just a hat. I mean, literally in Colorado, it's just a hat. Don't forget to wear a hat. It's cold out.
That in other places, that'll get you in so much trouble.
I've heard sock hat.
Yeah, I've heard sock
in
hat.
In Chicago a
or
bunch.
Sock cap or something like that. Yeah, we call them toboggans. And I think if it's not a southern thing in general, it must be a central Kentucky thing. Or at least around that area, because I saw a...
You say central Kentucky and I just hear redneck.
Why?
I don't know. Like, when you have to specify, like, well, that's mostly a Delbert County, Kentucky thing.
I didn't say anything about Delbert County.
Is there a Delbert County?
No. No, but between, the Lexington area. Uh-huh. And I saw a video on YouTube the other day that somebody put up. didn't say at all where they were from or anything, but they mentioned some guy having a Bengals jacket on, which, you know, chances are you're probably around the Cincinnati area or bleeding down into Kentucky or anything,
right.
Because Kentucky doesn't have any professional sports teams, so they go for Cincinnati area.
Right.
Anyway, and he, the guy in the video mentioned somebody having a toboggan. Didn't say they were from Kentucky. Didn't say they were from Ohio. Didn't say they were from the moon. You know, I did not know.
That's good though. Were. That bolsters your point.
That's exactly what I'm trying to say. So anyway, that's great.
So as you can guess, this week we're talking about hats on
weird hats on the show.
You know, before no, we're talking about springtime hats, Easter hats. You know,
you see them a lot in spring.
Yeah. I mean, the Kentucky Derby is really the official kickoff to the hat season.
And you kick with your foot, which has a heel on it.
Oh, yes. I didn't think a train could be steered off the tracks, but it can.
Because we've got spring, we've got heels.
Mm-hmm. And I'm surprised. Like I'm pretty pumped up. I'm jacked up about this. I'm pretty.
You're wadded up.
I guess with Jack.
Jack, we've got spring. We've got heels. We're talking about Spring Heel Jack tonight.
Spring Heel Jack, something that I'm really excited about. A couple weeks ago, I was able to bring the Bunyip to David Flora. He had never heard of the Bunyip before, and he has repaid in kind this week with Spring Heel Jack. David, please let us know what the hell's going on.
I will. I would like to point out that I came to know Spring Heel Jack through Monsters in My Pocket, the classic toy of little rubber cryptids.
I have never heard of that before.
Oh, man. Monsters in My Pocket had, like, just tons of neat creatures and cryptids from mythology and folklore. Spring Heel Jack was one of them, one of the common ones.
Wow, yeah. These are colorful and fun.
They're great, and they're also in our logo.
So oh, yeah?
Some of my own personal collection I threw in there with a wampa.
That's why these things look so familiar. So, Spring Heel Jack. Now, he is a Victorian England...
A figure of folklore.
I was gonna. I almost wanted to say cryptid, and that doesn't
it's
fit.
Weird, yeah. It's he's
kind of is, maybe.
He's uncategorized, I guess. Well, he could be a cryptid, he could be paranormal, it could be just myth.
Yeah, he's whatever it is. I guess it comes down to what do you personally decide that person is?
Yeah.
And then that's how you have to determine what it actually files
right.
under.
Right. So he's like you said, a Victorian era figure of folklore made infamous by his attacks on people and his apparent inhuman leaping ability.
Yeah.
That's where he gets the name Spring-Heeled. He was never caught.
Nope.
Whatever or whoever he was, never caught. It's unknown whether it was a real person or a supernatural entity or maybe an extraterrestrial or maybe just an urban legend.
Yeah, maybe just there's a lot of references to maybe he just, you know, an event happened. He's notable for attacking women.
Yeah.
Young women.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe there was like a group hysteria, but things got fleshed out in the story of Spring Heel Jack. So let's, David Flora, maybe we'll just walk through the abilities.
Great.
If Spring Heel Jack was an X-Man, which maybe he was, what are Spring Heel Jack's mutant abilities?
Well, his mutant abilities would be, like we said, a supernatural leaping ability.
Most notably,
he could leap over hedgerows and walls that otherwise would either be unscalable by humans or with very great difficulty be able to
they would need over. Significantly more time than he took to do it.
Right, and probably a ladder.
Mm-hmm.
Now the reports vary on his appearance. But most say that he was tall and thin. Mm-hmm. He wore skin-tight clothing, and he had red eyes and sharp metallic claws.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, he also had cold, clammy hands.
Yeah, cold skin.
Yeah, and occasionally he breathed blue and white flames out his mouth hole.
So he's pretty, as X-Men go. Metallo claws. He's got Wolverine claws. He's got maybe not like that, but he's got metallic claws. He can leap. He can shoot flame out of his mouth.
Yeah.
Spooky eyes.
He's kind of like a cross between Wolverine and Nightcrawler and Pyro.
Yeah, and the Mothman.
You know, that old X-Man. He also occasionally wore a cloak or a cape,
mm-hmm.
some reports say. Now, there are, like I said, several reports of how he was described, but some of them include him looking kind of devil-like, or even wearing a large helmet with tight white oilskin clothing, they say. Some people and reports say he had a long chin, a long pointy chin, and he was quite thin or even gaunt. And some reports even say he was half man, half bat, complete with wings and horns and a tall 3/4 length boots.
So I, you know, my first reading over this, when I first started to read it, I was thinking England's Mothman, straight up.
Yeah, with the red eyes,
the red flaming eyes. You know, the people would approach him thinking he was just a dude, just a gentleman out for a stroll. But that quickly failed because this guy does not fit the Mothman MMO.
No.
That would be the Mothman massively multiplayer online, as I just went MMO. But this guy, Springheel Jack, pretty focused. Things he likes to do, scare women.
Yep.
And those are the good cases. In the good cases, he'll shoot some flames out of his mouth and really just scare the hell out of somebody and then run down the street giggling.
Yeah, yeah.
More often than not, the objective is the chest. He is a blouse ripper.
Yep.
At least two of the accounts that I read, he attacks a woman attempting to rip her clothes off.
Yeah, he's pretty touchy-feely.
Yeah, and that's why we get so many details about the clawed hands, the metallic hands, and there were marks left on the women. They were cut, but these brief, sudden, violent attacks, and then he just takes off.
Yep, disappears into the night. One of my favorite aspects to him is that he was real big into slapping the hell out of authority figures.
Yeah. He was a slapper.
He would attack women and tear at their clothes, and he would come up and just slap the shit out of some policeman.
And then just take off.
Take off laughing.
Woohoo!
It makes him kind of endearing.
Well, so, I mean, if it weren't for the sexual assaults.
Yeah. Let's go through the sightings.
Yeah, please.
Sightings might date back as far as an 1808 ghost sighting of a similar type of entity.
Mm-hmm.
Something that comes and either attacks women or has this inhuman leaping ability.
Yeah.
But officially, really, in 1837... he attacked some women around London. Now, it wasn't in London proper. It was kind of the villages around London. But one of them was Polly Adams, who was a farmer's daughter.
So he's more of a suburban menace.
So yeah, exactly. Then another woman was Mary Stevens, which didn't have an occupation that I could find. Yeah. So who cares?
Homemaker.
And both of those, he leaps at them from a dark alley as they're walking home late at night. And he rips up their clothes, and he tries to give them smooches, and then he's scratching at them, and then leaps away, cackling. And then, either the next day or soon thereafter, he jumps in front of a passing carriage, and he causes the coachman to lose control and crash, which severely injured the coachman. But again, he leaps away cackling like, you know, it's all good fun for him.
And it seemed to be, that was another one of his patterns. And I don't know if this figures into it being a hysterical thing or multiple people trying to pull a similar maneuver, but there's almost three different approaches of Springheel Jack stories. There is the Springheel Jack that likes to scare young women and attack them.
Mm-hmm.
There's the Springheel Jack that likes to run up and slap people and run away. And then there's
authority figures.
Yeah, authority figures. And then there's the coach crasher.
Yeah.
Because that wasn't an isolated thing. This concept of him jumping in front of a coach, causing it to crash, and then running away.
Yeah.
It's interesting. He seems to have three very separate MMOs and about how he wants to...
Yeah, and nothing really deviating from that. from those three types of quote-unquote attacks.
And all three of the those things mention that that his means of escape is this amazing leaping ability.
Yep. He just, which made him nigh impossible to chase after.
Right.
So with him scaling hedgerows and bounding over walls and things, you know, people couldn't catch up to him, which is how he remained a mystery. In 1838, Sir John Cowan, who was the Lord Mayor of London, was brought a case of Springhill Jack. He was skeptical of the reports, and he thought it was all just total exaggeration.
Right.
You know, he thought maybe it was one isolated incident that people just blew out of proportion, or maybe the newspapers or something got a hold of it and, you know,
did what he probably said that it was hogwash or perhaps poppycock.
True. Because we're not yet at the point where horse feathers was in, in play.
Exactly.
But the funny thing is he had quite a few reports of similar attacks like this. So it wasn't just the one that he was that was brought to him. He even had a letter that had been given to him that spoke of a wager that happened between some aristocrats that said one of them was bet that he couldn't visit London villages as a ghost, a bear, and a devil, dressed up, I guess, in that guise.
And I know that this is something we've mentioned before, but for the love of God, is there anything, with the exception of American children in the early 20th century, more dangerous than bored British rich kids?
Right.
If they're not making secret societies, they're making ridiculous bets. They're making everyone's life a nightmare.
Lord Daft Wager.
Man, it always comes back to these bored rich British kids.
Yep. So there was that sort of compelling evidence that the Lord Mayor had to deal with. A month after that, a girl named Jane Alsop heard a knock at her door, and oh my, someone's at the door. Where's the butler to... Oh, we're not rich enough for a butler.
Jane Alsop, stop asking about a butler and answer the bloody door!
Yes, mother, yes, mother. So, she opens the door.
What the f*** happened?
Go with it, dude, just go with it. She opens the door. It's a man who's standing out by the front gate, right?
Oh yeah, this is elaborate. What's important is that the butler didn't answer it.
Exactly. She opens the door. There was a voice out there saying,
"Oi, for the love of God, bring us a light. We've cut Springhill Jack out in the alley."
Too right.
Too right. Give us a light then. Come on, love.
That's a good girl, then, eh?
So,
why don't you have your butler go grab us a lantern or a candle? And that's when she started crying.
Is that man out there asking about a butler?
We're not rich enough for a butler. Oh, I'm sorry, sir.
We're terrible at this.
That's all right. I'll get a taste of those crumpets myself.
It's all nothing but a clever ruse.
Forgive and forget, as long as it gets me tasty.
Oh, God. Springhill Jack, you son of a bitch.
Sorry, everybody. What it really was,
so... Okay.
So now that we're done with Masterpiece Theater.
Someone approaches the door.
All right.
They say they need a light because they have captured Springhill Jack, to which Ms. Alsop
says, here's the torch, and opens the door. And it's actually Springhill Jack himself, who spits flames in her eyes, blue and white flames, tears at her clothes and her face, and then he leaps away.
Don't feel bad, love. It was all a clever ruse.
You're not the first one it has happened to, eh?
Now that, I mean, even though we just so clearly said, well, he's got just a few M.O.s, that's new. That's pretty elaborate.
Coming to your house.
I mean, that's a guy who has chosen his target at that point,
yeah.
You think?
Or, I mean, it could have been random. She could have just it'd been the luck of the draw there. But it is, yeah, you're right. It's definitely different from what he's been doing, where he's just grabbing girls out of alleys.
I was just passing through. Figured I'd have myself a bit of a squeeze. Came up with a right Johnny plan. I'm just terrible at this.
He, a week after, he leaps from an alley. So he goes back to that thing. Leaps from an alley at a girl named Lucy Scales. And he breathes...
That was her nickname.
Because of how she looked? Wow. Nice. Mm-hmm. Great.
I don't know.
Well, maybe she's a precursor to Illuminati.
Yep.
Reptilian. So he breathes fire at her, and with her, she just, it scared her so bad that she just dropped to the ground and started having fits and seizures.
Right.
And so he just sort of, like, left. He didn't even try scratching at her. He just, you know.
Mission accomplished.
Yep. Back in the shadows he goes. So, from then on, the sightings were mostly sporadic and pretty widespread over England. The worst apparently being an 1845 murder of a 13-year-old prostitute by the name of Maria Davis.
Wow, that's rough.
Yeah.
A 13-year-old prostitute.
It's rough on many levels.
Boy.
I mean, it was blamed on him that he just came out in broad daylight and tossed her off a bridge.
That sounds like pimp behavior.
If it sounds like anything, it sounds like not what he has been doing or known for.
Yeah.
So that one to me was kind of like, because he hasn't killed anybody up to this point. He's just been kind of a righteous ass, you know?
Yeah. That doesn't seem to fit anything that he does or is interested in. And most importantly, in broad daylight.
Right. That was weird, but that's out there as a thing that's attributed to him.
Huh.
Now, in the 1870s, he was reported in many different places, mostly going around slapping soldiers and authority figures and just cackling. Like, he was reported going around soldiers' sentry boxes and things like that, like jumping on them or coming up to him out of the dark and slapping him and running off. And...
Which is pretty ballsy.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, they do have guns.
There's one report in 1837 in a place called Aldershot, where they had a barracks. One of the soldiers said a figure came out of the darkness, and he issued several slaps to the soldier's face.
Bam! 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 Bam!
And then he was spotted and chased in Lincolnshire, but never actually caught. A lot of people set traps for him, which he cackled and avoided. And some people reported shooting him almost point blank, and the shot having no effect on him, and him just leaping away. Now that could be conjecture or, you know, exaggeration.
Yeah. But
the last reported sightings were in Liverpool. Between 1888 and 1904. But there were a couple of more sort of sightings or people sort of, you know, later came forward and said, like, in 1986, there was a British Army officer who was apparently bicycling through Herefordshire.
What is that? It's in Beatles lyrics.
And when somebody came out of the corner of his eye, leapt onto the road, slapped the shit out of him, and then leapt away. I love that his main attack is just to slap the hell out of somebody.
He sounds it's almost like some kind of weird
practical joke.
Yeah, it's like a Dave Chappelle, you know, super villain sketch.
Yeah,
you
know?
The night slap.
There were, now, some reports that he was sighted in the U.S. He was reported accosting women in Louisville, Kentucky in 1880. And
I was hoping you were saying 1980. I was like, that's Rick James, bitch.
The weird thing with these reports is that he had a blue light that was coming out of his chest. From what I read, it made it sound kind of like Iron Man style.
Right, it's like, this is Tony Stark.
But instead of breathing this blue and white flame, it was coming out of his chest for that. In 1938 through 1945, he was reported several times in Cape Cod, Massachusetts, and Provincetown. A lot of people apparently saw him and his leaping and slapping and accosting.
He was leap-slapping vacationers?
I guess. Or maybe just the lobster fisherman.
Nice f***ing chowder. Bam! F*** you, Jack!
Bring Hill Jack! Wicked awesome.
I'm gonna leap over those hedges in your yard.
And you can't stop me.
No, asshole.
An asshole.
That's right. Spring Hill Jack. Asshole.
In 1953, he was seen in Houston, Texas.
Shooting pistols into the air, celebrating his oil billions.
And that one was funny because it's like a lot of people that are under the extraterrestrial reference for him, they like this story because he leaps into a pecan tree and then kind of disappears, and then like moments later people see this metallic cigar shaped object fly away from the area. So people are like, yeah, we're extraterrestrial. Anyway.
Yeah, and we'll get to that. I mean, as we alluded to early on, there is such a weird list of potential. If everyone's got a theory.
Yeah.
It's going to be a hell of a list, so.
Yeah. Well, let's get into some of the explanations.
Yeah, let's just do that list then.
Why
tease it?
What this guy should be or could be. Now, we'll start out with the prime suspect.
Yeah, we actually have a dude. A dude we can pin this on to a degree. And as always, there's two things that are at the root of every single problem with cryptids. Sandhill cranes and the Irish.
Our primary suspect is Henry Beresford, the third Marquess of Waterford, who was an Irish nobleman born in 1811.
I love this guy.
Yeah.
You know, like, there was a bunch of Irish noblemen who are sitting in a pub explaining to someone else that, say, and the gist of this conversation was, yeah, but he's our asshole.
Oh, aye, but we love him so much.
He can be a bit of a handful from time to time, but he's our arsehole.
He means well, bless his heart.
His mother was a haint.
His father worked in Liverpool. He pulled on the ships on the dock.
Shut your dirty mouth.
All right.
The Marquess, also known as the Mad Marquess.
Yeah.
Are we saying that right? Is it Marquess? Marquis?
I think it's Marquess because he's not French. He's Irish.
We will never make that mistake.
Yeah, this guy was well known for his bawdiness.
Oh, God. Everything in my life so that someday two jackwads will Wikipedia me, and it'll say, known for his bawdiness.
Me.
That's going on my tombstone. Yeah. Died of bawdiness. He was frequently drunk. He was always fighting. He would vandalize things, always joking around, and he'd do anything for a bet.
Also or, harassing in other words, kids about boxes of cereal. It was a Lucky Charms joke there.
Oh, I get it.
This guy is not an Irishman. He is the Irishman.
Yeah. Here's a fun fact about this guy that I saw.
like we're not having fun yet.
Strap in. He may have been the first to paint the town red.
Literally?
Literally. Now, this is where some people think that saying comes from. After a successful fox hunt, he came back into town with his boyos and phoned some tens of red paint, and he proceeded to just splotch it on every building that he came across.
Hey, that was a fine fox hunt. What did you think, Lee?
What have we here?
There's a few pots of red paint. I got me an idea.
Splash, splash.
It's like a time machine. That's how good we are. Yep. You're welcome, everybody.
When you put those headphones on, you might as well be in 1811. So yeah, that's apparently where that saying comes from.
That's awesome.
Paint the town red because of this jag.
Now, so, well, yeah, okay, so we know he likes drinking.
He likes drinking, he likes fighting.
He likes painting things, hunting foxes.
Now, it's been suggested that he had a humiliating experience with a woman and or a police officer at some point
in his career. I repeat, not an Irishman, the Irishman.
This is the gold standard of stereotypes. Why isn't there a holiday to this guy?
Here's another thing. He may have had friends who were experts in applied mechanics.
No.
Which means he might have had them to design spring-heeled boots for him.
No, those were the kind of nerds we picked on. Oh, you like your bookie hooks there, do you?
I've got an eclectic group of friends. I like collecting them. Oh. This is my friend who likes D&D.
So he's got super engineer friends who are all like, hey, you know that drunk guy who likes making problems everywhere? Let's give him the ability to leap away from the authorities. Okay, you know what? Actually, when I say it out loud, it kind of does track. That kind of does make sense.
He may have also practiced fire spitting, because at this point, why the f*** not?
Right. Which is really because somebody just told a fart joke right when he was lighting his cigar.
That's the kind of the humor I think he would have invested a lot of his time
in. If he was alive, he'd be a great fan of ours. Except for the fact that we just spent the last 10 minutes laughing at him outright.
But doing a spot-on impersonation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, there was this one encounter with Spring-Heeled Jack where there was a servant that claimed to have spotted an embroidered W on Spring-Heeled Jack's cloak as he bounced away.
The W of Waterford.
Could be.
Now, is this guy in charge of crystal production? I think that is Waterford Crystal. That's...
Oh, do you think?
Yeah, I think it is.
By all accounts, when he married, and he did marry at some point, he settled down and became quite a nice old fellow.
He just didn't
bother anybody.
He put that leaf behind me. No more. I don't even know what accent I'm doing there.
It'll go in Lord of the Rings regardless.
Perfect. Yeah, exactly. I think
put that in there.
I'd fit in Mordor just fine.
Died of a horse riding accident. Too bad.
Now, was that a horse riding or a horse riding?
He died in 1859.
Okay.
But the Spring-Heeled Jack sightings continued after that, well after that, which leads some people to say, well, were there multiple Spring-Heeled Jacks? Or were there a bunch of copycats? Maybe the Marquess went out a couple times and grabbed some boobies and honked some noses. But
I'm glad that you put out the boobies thing, because can you call it a copycat if, like, more than one guy jumped out of an alley and grabbed a girl's boobs? Like
I'd call that a Saturday.
This is my homage to the perfect crime. That's just...
Oh, I've got to try that myself.
I would like to imagine a lot of drunk Irishmen thinking themselves to be Spring-Heeled Jack and just getting caught instantly.
Yeah.
You'll never catch me! Oh!
I've one-upped Spring-Heeled Jack. I've attached dynamite to my heels. Watch me grab them boobies and then explode away.
Oh, them sweet titties are mine. For the record, it's never okay to jump out of an alley and grab at a woman's chest.
True.
Ever.
True story. Even today.
Mm-hmm.
Especially today.
Even today. I know what you're thinking. Well, surely by now we've reached a point where that's okay. I'm afraid we're not there yet.
Sorry, guys. Keep
keep it locked down.
Keep it on lockdown.
Come on.
Yeah, a lot of these guys, if they're copycats, they get drunk. They go out, they hide in an alley, and then they fall smack on their gobs. Let me get a taste of those boobs. Whack.
Thump. And clapped in irons.
Now, some German paratroopers apparently experimented with spring-heeled boots, springs in their boots, during World War II.
You know, I'm sure... I'm sure that the springs in their boots were exactly the thing they needed to ensure victory. How did that turn out for those guys?
It actually resulted in quite a few broken ankles.
Oh,
didn't work out for them too well. So springs and boots, not such a great idea.
No. Well, I mean, they're paratroopers, so I mean, they were using them kind of in reverse.
I would think if you're going to do that, then you'd probably use them to absorb some shock of landing, right?
I think that was the plan. But maybe they trusted him too much and locked their knees like idiots. I don't know.
I don't know. They could learn a thing or two from the Irish.
Oh, you could have touched a titty, but you didn't, did you? You didn't learn anything from me.
We'll never stop doing this. This podcast is over.
Cockney, Irish. We haven't done a voice for the German paratroopers. I guess nope. I guess we'll let you pass on that, listener.
I'll say this. I apologize for the amount of booby references.
Oh, I don't apologize for that. I apologize for the slaughtering of dialect.
It took us 20 episodes to get here. Finally, erotic mysteries. Can we pull back around to the Palladians for another episode?
I have to feel. I feel like the Marquess had a game plan drawn up where one, springs in your boots.
Yeah.
Two,
right.
Three, boobies.
Something, something.
A boob. Boobies.
Boobies equals profits. And that's, yeah. I also looked up methanol, which is a wood alcohol. It's the simplest alcohol. Methanol apparently can burn with a blue flame.
Yeah.
You know, Spring Hill Jack, famous for shooting white blue flames out of his face. It was developed purely by 1661 and was really nailed down in the 1800s. So it could have been used by whoever Spring Hill Jack was, as a burning mechanism, you know?
You know what else I was thinking about this? When I was reading these, what occurred to me is like a possible...
Here's a hypothesis.
Sure.
Flash powder.
Right, yeah.
You know, the photography existed. It was in its early stages when you used these trays of flash powder.
Yeah, hold real still now.
Exactly.
10 minutes later.
Yeah. if you were to ignite some of this in the palm of your hand, just, you know, set it off... It would blind a person right in front of you.
Sure.
It burns obviously white, maybe blue with the smoke. I don't know, but that's just to my mind, you know, little conjecture there.
Yeah, why not? I mean, do you know anything about the dates of when they worked on that or when that was? I mean, obviously we said photography was coming into vogue then.
Yeah, that's why I made sure to say conjecture. It means conjecture is a Latin.
You confused me because you didn't say fun fact.
Yeah. Oh, see, I should have. Conjecture is a Latin word meaning I'm not going to look this up. I'm just going to say it for the sake of my own comfort and ease.
Yeah.
Yeah. You. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, why not? Like, I mean, you could pin the stuff that he did on, you know, any number of explanations and things like that. Or you could go straight for the pinning the tail on the donkey.
Oh, yeah. Let's lose our damn minds now, because here's the thing that is fun about this. When you boil it down, Springheel Jack is just a booby grabber. But he did it with a crazy amount of panache, with just enough mystery to make him kind of a piece of folklore.
Yeah.
And so let's focus on the folklore. Let's focus on the weird. And let's stop thinking that a human being could possibly come up with the wherewithal to stun another person and touch their boobs. This could only be from another realm.
Yeah, it could be just an exaggeration of folk tales. It could be the boogeyman that parents used to scare, you know.
If you spelled boogie with a B replacing the G.
Boogeyman. Why did it take me a second?
It did, and that's what I like about it.
Could be a ghost.
Now, I listened to a really interesting interview. When I was researching this, I found a YouTube video that was really just a long audio file of an interview with a guy, and they covered a range of topics. I mean, things from Nazca lines and all kinds of things, but he talked about Spring Hill Jack for a while, and the overarching subject was aliens. And he really latched on to Springheel Jack as a great example of a potential stranded alien.
Yeah, that's the next thing through the looking glass here.
That perhaps that these, you know, it was a frightened alien, not necessarily boob obsessed. But you get those the thing that we haven't really everyone talks about the heels, the jumping ability.
Right.
An alien that comes from a high gravity world would easily be able to leap far more than what we'd expect. But the hands, the claws, they're always described as being metallic or a metallic substance. And even in, you know, some of the pictures people do, illustrations, it's always a leather glove with some kind of some metal ends. Yeah, exactly. But granted, they're blinded by blue-white fire. They're
blinded by the blue-white fire.
Don't you dare Manfred Mann this podcast. I'm ashamed of myself for knowing that.
Wrapped up like an Irish douche in the night. Night!
The other thing is that, and these women, you know, like, were so scared. In some cases, they have fits, you know. They really terrifies
them. Well, yeah, the one was incapacitated with fits.
So
he was just like, all right.
You're like really high maintenance. But the weird consistency is that the people always say metallic-like. Like, there's no, oh, he was wearing a glove with claws on it. There's no, it's always this somewhat vague.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that kind of opens the door to a possible not-human thing. That there's this consistent lack of specificity on the hands, on the claws themselves.
Yeah.
And, you know, a very dense creature, high-gravity world.
Yeah. Phosphorus breath, maybe.
Yeah. Phosphorus breath. That's brilliant.
Infrared eyes, you know, maybe they see in a different spectrum or something.
Radar ears.
All right. All right. All right. We're trying to have a serious conversation.
It smells with lasers.
Radar ears.
Laser. Get out.
Laser olfactory senses. No.
No.
Did you ever see the John Carter, the movie?
I did. I watched it with my family.
Oh.
4 hours I'll never get back.
I keep thinking of him, like, you know, how he is on Mars. He's able to leap, you know, just huge distances. Or like the stupid-ass Hulk. In any of the Hulk movies,
Okay, whoa. The Hulk is not a stupid ass. The Hulk is awesome. Has he been mistreated in many movie representations? Yes. But the Hulk is awesome.
Sorry, dude. I'm not a Hulk fan. Even in the Avengers cartoon series that's out now.
What about... No, the Hulk in the Avengers, the Ruffalo Hulk, was awesome.
The best Hulk that there's been, yeah.
Hands down.
But that doesn't make me like the Hulk. Oh, my superpower is to just get angry and smash shit.
Yeah! It's brilliant because it's so simple.
Yeah. Yeah, you
don't
should
do anything I don't like, or I destroy everything.
Well, yeah, and I'm indestructible. Kids should know that the more angry they get, the more indestructible they are.
He's a toddler that a tank can't kill. Oh man! All right, stupid ass Hulk.
Anyway, these are examples of you know, people defying the gravity.
Yeah,
jumping, you know, big jumping. God, this is dumb. Just forget the last 2 minutes, everybody.
I'm gonna remember.
Here's a no subliminal messages. here's the end of the rainbow. The pot of gold that we get with Springheel Jack.
Remember the Irish guy? We're bringing it back.
Springheel Jack could be a tulpa.
What?
Could be created by a cultist simply to cause mischief.
Tibetans make it to Ireland?
I mean, it's people that practice the occult. Could be just, you know, brain power, thinking something like this into existence.
The Irish are people not known for their focus.
Oh, maybe it's not the Irish doing it. Okay. I mean, tulpas can be created by anybody who has the focus and determination.
All right. I'm just saying.
I mean, hell, I think they even say if you keep picturing the same scenario over and over and worry about it and fret and stuff, that it could happen. Like, if you picture yourself getting mugged every day when you go home.
I picture myself getting mugged by a guy, but he's giving me hundreds of dollars. You take this money! Shut your mouth and take this money!
I picture myself getting mugged by beautiful women every night.
They just punch you and take your wallet?
Whatever works, man. Whatever works.
What's important is that they're beautiful.
Okay, so I haven't thought this tulpa through.
Tulpa, that is shocking. Yeah. I am amazed that the tulpa showed up at this point.
That's your pot of gold here.
Wow. Now here's something interesting. Springhill Jack fits into a very specific subset of unknown entities known as Phantom Attackers. Thunder sound. Which we have not done for a little while. It's true. Bringing it back.
It's true. Sorry, everybody.
Yeah. Phantom Attackers.
Huh.
Also in this weirdly specific little niche, the Mad Gasser of Mattoon.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Who, known here in our native state of Illinois, not native in that we were born here, but it's where our mail shows up. You know, there's this weird, these phantom attackers, these unknown entities or people who just show up, whoop some ass, and just disappear.
Yeah. Nobody knows whence they came, why, or who they were.
Yeah.
It's kind of getting into, Springhill Jack, to me, is almost in the same boat as Jack the Ripper.
I was just thinking that. Like, it's getting into that kind of weird, I mean, the arc from back alley booby grabber to cutting, you know, to sending Scotland Yard pieces of a prostitute's liver.
True. There's definitely a bridge to cross there.
Right. And it's a huge bridge, and it's called f***ing insane, is what that bridge is called.
I don't know, Governor. Maybe those oars had it coming.
Their ghosts will haunt you.
Maybe it's not up to them whether they show up. Brown what's all this or not, in
there? I started that bit of fun. Had me some boots made.
Grabbing me some boobies there.
I wish... What is a great Cockney word for boobs?
Send
us emails, please.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with
rubber tubes. Right?
Rubber tubes?
It's a rhyming thing.
Right, I was grabbing me a little bit of a rubber tubes there.
I've got to say, it sounds like you're talking about dongs.
I had me a bit of that Tony Shalhoub there. Stuck it right in front of me loaf of bread.
Oh, whoa. I get the Cockney rhyming slang. Please, I've never done this. I'm calling out an individual because we happen to have a good friend who is an expert at this era language.
Oh.
Mel Evans. What word did Jane Austen use for boobs?
Help us!
No, wait. I would like to point out that Jane Austen word for boob and Cockney word for boob.
All right, but I'm saying in an era.
All right.
Yeah, so let's Mel Evans, you're...
I don't think they discussed it. You can't discuss that sort of stuff. Oh my, what would the vicar say?
So yeah, okay, so if Springhill Jack went trouncing through Downton Abbey, which he had attacks in that exact same time frame.
That's true.
What do we do with that?
Does he attack Mary? Is there a Mary? Does he attack Todd? Who is on Downton Abbey?
No. It's...
Can he attack Firefly Time so we name is what?
It's Carrie. Then there's the redhead one, Miranda. Yeah, that's what happened.
And then Shoeface McBuys-a-Lot.
Yeah, that's the one. Now, wait. I'm going to stop right now and apologize for that. So I'm sorry to take a dump on your sexes in cities.
And your Downtons and Abbeys.
Yeah. The point being,
for a long time, I thought it was Downtown Abbey, and people were just saying it like they said it in the show. Downton Abbey. I was like, oh, Downtown Abbey, you know, the one that's in the middle of the town, church.
It's a Downtown Abbey.
What would the vicar say?
You know what? That's what we need to ask ourselves. I'm getting some rubber bracelets made.
Better than rubber tubes, eh, Mike?
WWVS. What would the vicar say?
I don't know why every time I talk with a Cockney accent, me hands do this, though.
I don't... I can't begin to describe what you're... Did you just cast a spell on me with your hands?
It's kind of like I'm moving them around a crystal ball, but they're also like seizing up with muscle spasms.
Yeah, it's like your hands have rickets. Just your hands.
Me hands are all hanks and tickets.
Oh, which is also Cockney slang for rickets. So, well done. Right. You brought it around. So, Springheel Jack.
Hey.
You've never heard of him. Don't pretend you have. And if you have, high five.
And if you have, high five, and you now know more, hopefully, than you ever wanted to.
You heard more. We'll say that.
You heard about it a lot.
Yeah. I don't know about knowledge.
You heard about it some. You heard a lot of dialects.
But this is perfect. This is exactly what we've loved to talk about. This is a weird, fun corner. And thank you, David Flora, for bringing it to my attention.
Oh, you're welcome. And for everyone else, that's Springheel Jack in a sprungy, fire-breathing nutshell.
Right. Oh, man.
Well, say we hit a bit of the puns there, Governor.
Oh, fancy some puns that night. All right, kick this thing off, Flora. I want you to have the first crack at rhyming the name Springheel Jack.
Because that's all we got.
That's what we've got.
I've got an armor store that's open once a year. Mm-hmm. It's called the Spring Shield Shack.
Oh, I get it, because it's in the springtime.
And, yeah.
For summer campaigning. Okay. All right, I've got... I'm ready to join this pun war.
Oh.
Uh-huh. So, in the aftermath of these terrible attacks, the plucky people of the English countryside decided to try to put a good spin on it. So they started an annual race, a steeplechase of sorts, where individuals would have to run around a track with obstacles. Uh-huh. And they would have to alternate between slapping people of authority. They'd get some British officers there. They had to slap the officers and grab the breasts of women who were also lined up in the track. And the place they would always hold this was called the Springfield Track. They would have it in the springtime.
Why is this not an Olympic sport?
I agree totally. And I'd also like to apologize because, you see, sometimes you do a podcast, you research it, but no matter how hard you try, you're really just lashed, tied to the mast of one boat, and it's just one phrase, and that's the one thing you have to work with. So I'm really, really sorry.
Well, I'm really sorry that this isn't an Olympic sport, because if it were... You'd be doing a podcast with a gold medalist, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. We're that good. Well, let's see what happens in the next round where the scores can really change. Mr. Flora?
Okay, double or nothing here. I have a pouch store, a place where you can buy pouches of different sorts, called the String Sealed Sack.
And, sir, you win. Now, I've got some terrible news. I was trying to be competitive. I knew I was up against it, and I'd like to announce that I'd been doping throughout this entire Pun Olympics, and I am out. I leave competition, and so I can no longer use that phrase legally. So instead, I provide you with the following. What a dumb metaphor. I gave you a headline from the Waterford Courier newspaper in the year 1846.
Uh-huh.
A lot of public distrust of the local Randy Irishman.
That's redundant.
And so the headline of the Waterford Courier read, "Confess, Marquess, and end this mess." Something, something, boobies dress. I fought for that, too. I fought that one. That was not easy to come up with.
Well, I salute you, sir. I salute you for limping to the finish line, as it were. And I just want to say, what if there was a doping scandal with the old boob and slap event?
Oh man, yeah. What if the guy had slap?
What do you grope and slap? What is it called?
Well, it's actually the root of the British phrase, the old slap and tickle.
Yeah! Woo! I made it historical.
Revisionist history. H officer got a quite crack on the gob, and each lady got the most delicate of jiggles.
Or like watching me a bit of the old pap and pickle.
I don't know why it needed a replacement, but
the pap and pickle. That is the name of the worst pub in England.
Behind the Hayton ticket.
I'm going to open a pub called the Hayton ticket.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, man. We're sorry.
Sort of.
But we're proud, too.
Humble and proud of our heritage.
Hey.
Suddenly we're Scottish. Right. Which has nothing to do with it. But I think they would do well at the old slap and tickle.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. If you can toss a caber, you can grab a booby.
I'll tell you what, not to be outdone by one of our frenzied listeners.
Oh, yes.
The magnanimous Greg has graced us with yet another few puns for us.
Oh, we got
to throw on the bandwagon.
It's Greg Bach and he rocks. It's a rock block of Bach because his name is Greg Bach and something something rocks.
Who, he might be starting up his own podcast soon, huh?
Oh, he had better. I'm going to lose my mind if he does that. I cannot wait, and we will plug it daily, nightly, and never so rightly. You know, for all of our listeners. We'll divert some of our huge traffic his way. Hope his servers can handle it.
Those of you who are listening, thank you, though.
I mean it. Yeah, thank you. Really, you're like precious, precious gems to us.
So, before we jump on the Greg train this week, we have another pun.
Oh, sweet!
From one of our great listeners. This is, you're gonna like this one. This is great. This is from listener Chris.
Uh huh. Hi, Chris.
Hey, Chris. Thank you so much for writing in. This is great. You're going to love this, Dave. Chris says he found this headline in the Australian newspaper. Pregnant billabong siren found. Has bunyip in the oven.
Yes! Yes! Yes, thank you, Chris.
Well played, Chris. That's awesome.
But, yeah. But seriously, that thing is terrifying.
Greg has graced us with a couple of puns.
Bring it.
For this week. All right, Greg says, at Greek festivals all over the world, fathers send their daughters to the place where they are told to remain pure until their wedding day. It's called the anti-kissing booth.
I like that.
From Antikythera.
Oh, yeah, I get it. I see where you were at there.
Make sure you're on the same page.
Of course I was. No kissing.
Hey, Greg says there's a new hip-hop label.
Really?
Yeah, with only the best MCs. Called Dopest Stones Discs.
Oh, you know what? You know who might be signed to them?
Diggy Toots!
Oh, yes. Thank you, Greg, for giving Diggy Toots a place to lay down his sweet beats.
Right. Has the train pulled out of the station?
No. You get to stare at its sweet loose caboose as it rolls away. Yeah. This is also from our last podcast, the Out of Place Artifacts. If you live in Dorchester, Mass, and you got water leaking everywhere, call Bargain Pipes. Our deals are wicked smart. These are the Bargain Pipes.
Bargain Pipes.
Wicked smart. Thank you, one, for an awesome pun.
Yes.
Thank you, two, for a reason to go back to in Dorchester!
Dorchester, MA!
You guys want some Dorchester pot? Oh, thank you, Greg.
You thought the train had pulled away. It just got the town, whore.
You stupid bastards!
Oh, no.
God.
We can't open up that can.
Oh, man.
That's got to remain on the shelf.
Thank you, Greg, for just letting us visit briefly.
I'll tell you what, though, we got one more.
Okay,
and I've been dreading it, but I can't deny it. This is from a listener, Guinevere McO's.
Well, wait a minute. What are Guinevere's initials?
Well, G M.
I think the O's sound. I think it's GMO's, dude. Don't get cute.
All right. So her name is her initials are GMO. Great.
I hope it's a coincidence, because I love the name Guinevere.
Guinevere says, I would like to place both Davids in the penalty box.
What?
The entire GMO episode was all about explaining GMOs to me, and not once were GMOs explained to me in a pumpkin metaphor.
F**k.
Gwyn, you are correct.
You are right.
And I apologize.
Son of a bitch, she's totally right. We did an entire podcast about agriculture.
Never mentioned.
The pumpkin, that's the thing that makes every... Oh, she's right. It's fine. We've earned this one. She's right.
She's absolutely right. All right. Well, I guess we should go on and get this over with.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to go first? Do you want me to go first?
You go ahead and go first.
All right.
Ugh. I went last time, by the way.
Yeah, you did. You did.
So I think it's your turn. All right. Thank you, Gwyn, for calling us out. That is completely in line with what we want.
Yeah.
And what you should do as your duty.
Yep, you have done your duty. And thank you for pointing out, because we're wrong. See how easy it is to say that?
Yep.
When you don't have an ego wrapped up with it, you can just look the truth in the face. Ever heard of it? It's called the truth. Yeah, it's for real.
Stares at you a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of whether or not you want to admit it. All right.
At this point, I'm just putting off the pedal.
Yeah, we need to get in this thing.
Delaying. All right, into the box with me. We've got our materials. I'm going to read a recognizable soliloquy, and I'm not even going to identify it, because if you don't know it, God have mercy on your soul.
Yeah.
All right, on go the headphones. And we enter the penalty box. Jesus! Okay. Episode 4, A New Hope. It is a period of civil war. Rebel spaceships striking from a hidden base have won their first victory against the evil Galactic Empire. During the battle, Rebel spies managed to steal secret plans to the Empire's ultimate weapon, the Death Star. An armored space station with enough power to destroy the entire planet. Pursued by the Empire's sinister agents, Princess Leia races home aboard her starship, custodian of the stolen plans that can save her people and restore freedom to the galaxy.
Oh, man.
And I'm out. God.
I have to say, you got better as you went along, though.
Yeah, every now and then I could, like, focus it in, and then I'd lose it again. Like, when I started, like, a new sentence, it was over again.
That's so great.
All
right, I guess I gotta go in.
Yeah, you do.
All right.
Get your ass in the box. Get him in the box!
All right, it's my turn in this beast. So, we have selected for me the president's speech from Independence Day.
Mm-hmm.
The
Bill Pullman.
President Bill Pullman. The speech from Independence Day, great. That's, if you don't know that speech, don't worry. You'll recognize it, maybe. Anyway, in I go.
Get in there.
All right, I have the other headphones on right now. Good morning. In less than an hour, aircraft from here will join others from around the world, and you will be launching the largest aerial battle in this history of mankind. Mankind. That word should have new meaning for us all of us today. We can't be consumed by our petty differences anymore. We will be united in our common interests. Perhaps it is fate that today is the 4th of July, and you will once again be fighting for our freedom, not from tyranny, oppression, or persecution, but from annihilation. We're fighting for our right to live, to exist. And should we win the day, the 4th of July will no longer be known as an American holiday, but as the day when the world declared in one voice, we will now go quietly into the... We will not vanish without a fight. We're going to live on. We're going to survive. Today, we celebrate our Independence Day.
Hooray!
Oh, God.
I can't. It's deliciously brutal. That one hit you a lot harder than the last one did.
I think I just need to abandon all caution and just do it.
Oh, yeah.
Because I was probably worried about talking slow last time and being understood. Yeah, fuck that. You just need to say it. Just read it.
Yeah. Oh, that was brilliant.
Wow. All right. Well, thanks, Gwen McO.
Yeah, you dirty haint.
Bruce Howell. Well,
now that we've paid our debt to society, now let's continue giving.
Yes.
There are some individuals out there who need to be recognized. I'd like to lead the charge. Now, we've mentioned him before. He virtually provided us an entire podcast in October.
Yeah.
Mr. Kenneth Haidt, who we love dearly, is not only a very talented writer, but he too has thrown his hat into the podcast ring, which is, you know, pretty great, right?
It's a big ring.
So Ken, our good friend, he's got a podcast with his friend Robin Laws, Robin D. Laws, and they are both very successful individuals. I know Ken is a very prolific writer and also works a lot in the role-playing game industry.
Ooh.
Which I like the idea of an industry. Like there's thousands.
That's a big industry, dude.
20-sided dice just rolling out the back of a factory.
Oh, man.
But no, it's a fascinating podcast. They talk about really interesting things, even if you're not into role-playing games. But there's this interesting thing, the podcast that I've just recently listened to talked about the difference between in time. There's the time that the characters and whatever, whether it's a video game or whatever you're playing, experience versus the time that the players experience and how a game has to manage those two things.
Sure.
Also, some really great political discussion. I mean, these guys really cover a lot of ground. And if you have the time, it's definitely worth listening to.
If you don't have the time, thanks, Obama.
Yeah! See how we can do political.
Yeah, we got that covered.
I think you're so special, Ken. He is special. So please check it out on iTunes. It's called Ken and Robin Talk About Stuff. You'll love it. It's absolutely great.
And we've mentioned in this podcast, referenced our good friend Mel Evans.
Oh, yeah.
Who has a wonderful podcast with Mark Colum called An Hour with Your Ex.
Yep.
Go listen to that. They take some type of media that one or the other hasn't seen or heard or read and force them.
They literally have a gun and they trade off either week and they hold the gun to the other person.
And so
it's a starter pistol. It doesn't have bullets.
It still hurts, man.
I know, but they care about each other, so they want to be safe.
So check that one out. That one's
please
fun.
Do. It's and I'll say this. I have a hard time with it because sometimes I'm not that hip. I don't like watch things when they come out. I'm way behind on Downton Abbey or Downtown Abbey. And so
really, I couldn't tell.
Sometimes
that
I have to skip an episode because I haven't seen the thing they're talking about.
Yeah.
But sometimes when I have, I get really excited.
So if you've ever seen, you know, Pulp Fiction or Jaws.
Yeah. Or maybe if you'd like to hear them discuss House of Cards, Mel Evans, maybe that would be fun for them to do a podcast about.
We want to extend a very, very huge and special thank you to an artist this week, Roger Langridge, who gave us permission to use his amazing Spring-Heeled Jack illustration.
Oh, yeah. It's awesome. So check it out.
Yeah.
Please.
You see it on the site and on our Facebooks and stuff. That's done by Roger Langridge. You can check out his stuff at hotelfred.com.
Mm-hmm.
That's his website. Amazing stuff.
And
Thank you so much, Roger.
He was really cool to let us use that because it was just the cherry on top of that sweet cupcake.
thank you so much for letting us use that, Roger. That's great. If you guys got a pun or a show suggestion or
please don't stop contributing because we love it.
Yeah. Go to our website, blurryphotos.org, and fill out that contact page that's on there with whatever you want to send us.
Yeah, send us stuff. We'll do it. You know what? Did we make a stupid mistake? Did my fun fact turn out to be no fact and less fun? Send us to the penalty box. You saw how much fun that is.
A serious untruth? Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, that's a malicious lie.
Yeah.
I think a fun fact and a malicious lie.
Malicious lie. Yeah, we'll go to the penalty box. Begrudgingly, but we'll go to it. Go to Facebook and please like us. We're almost to 50.
50?
50. We're so close. We're sniffing 50. All right, I'll end that there.
Yep, there we go. That's as far as that gets to go.
We're on blurry underscore photos is our Twitter handle.
Mm-hmm.
Go handle this on there.
You guys like sweet tweets? You gonna get them?
Not very often. We don't want to saturate your inbox. We just think we'd treat you each week. Just one tweet. A little treat for you.
Once a week, tweet treat.
Tweet treat. You know what? Here's some...
We have a two-man barbershop quartet. We'll show up at your place of work and give you balloons.
So the other thing that that we have that's for cereal to tell you about is we're going to take a small break.
Yep.
Just a tiny hiatus.
Yeah, it's so brief you won't even notice
it. Yeah, just a couple weeks or so.
And it's not because we don't love you. It's that we have become so boundlessly popular in our own families that we have to literally do a little bit of a technological overhaul.
Yeah, we're hoping to get some upgrades for you guys.
Yep.
Well, we're also maybe we've got some wangs and some buckets and some irons and fires and some horses and stables that hopefully are going to be released we're going to call it season two.
So congratulations on completing the first of many seasons of Blurry Photos.
Yeah, we hope to bring you guys more stuff, better stuff.
Yeah.
Harder stuff, faster stuff, stronger stuff.
And now here's the thing. I don't want this to be nebulous. I want you to know that we'll be back in no less than 3 weeks.
We'll be back in March, probably in time for St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, we'd better. We learned so many things just today about what we can do to celebrate Irish culture.
We'll start probably kick off the season maybe with something something nice for them.
Yeah, so please keep your eye on us. Don't leave us, because man, when we come back, we're gonna come back like swinging pipes of mystery. I really should have thought that through. I was launched off the cliff there.
I think we're good.
All right, okay, let's good, keep it. Good, we'll keep good.
It. I'm Vernon Cockney David Flora.
And I'm Dave Stecker. Fancy a jiggle feel?
Poof! Oh, where'd it go? Oh, my eyes. He had flash powder, he did.
This has been Blurry Photos.
Now piss off!
Slag off,
hey. Slag.
Boing.
Here's the end of the rainbow.
Holy shit. You have all of the Avengers and you don't have a Hulk.
What are you talking about?
At your home. Do you have a Hulk? Did you eschew the Hulk? Did you personally excise the Hulk out of the Avengers?
What? In what form? The Legos?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't have all of them. I've got Iron Man and Thor.
You've got Iron Man and Thor and more than that. You've got Loki. You've got like 1,000 Lokis.
I got one Loki. No, I have the Hulk. I have it in the little squinky thing.
Okay, all right. You got like two Lokis.
I've just got one Loki.
No, you got the...
I've got a can that has Loki on it.
No, you got the Loki that's in the Jeep.
And then you have Loki. Oh, you're right.
That's, yeah.
No, that Lego, yeah.
Oh, thank God.
But I don't have a Thor in that Lego.
No.
So here's the end of the rainbow.